Hey, it's Tommy Thayer from Kiss. And don't forget, you can get all your officially licensed merchandise, Kiss merchandise, at Rockabilia.
So, without any further ado, I would like to bring out an incredible guitar player, musician, and all-around fantastic guy, and the Kiss guitar player, Mr. Tommy Thayer. Yeah.
Thank you, geez. What a pleasure to be here. And thank you everyone for coming tonight and being part of this. It's great to see so many great friends and fans of the band out here today. And I know some people came from further away as well, and I really appreciate that. So it's great to be here. Thank you.
So a lot of you guys have submitted questions, and we're gonna work our way through those and just have a nice conversation with Tommy about everything from being in Kiss to being a musician and everything in between. So I'm gonna start and I'll do my best to read these. The first one, I'll just get this one out of the way. This is from Johnny Clifford, my childhood best friend. He's here, you'll meet him later. It says, Tommy Summer's first car was a Honda Civic and could seat 9 uncomfortably. What was your first car?
You know, my first car was given to me by a great aunt. And it was a 1963 Dodge 330 sedan. And I don't know if anybody knows what that is, but it was not a beautiful car at all. But it was, I was just happy at 16 years old to have a car that I could drive around. But like I said, it was 1963, and this had a 3 on the tree. Does anybody know?
Yes.
So you know how bad that is. 3 on the tree, and it was kind of an off, ugly brown color, but that was my first car, a Dodge, 1963 Dodge 330 sedan.
Excellent.
Had a big trunk, though, to put guitars and things in it.
Yeah, because I was just thinking, how much gear can you get in something like that? Charlie Corin would like to know, what song from your former band would work nicely on a Kiss album?
Ooh, he's talking about Black and Blue,
Black and Blue.
My band back in the 80s. We had 4 albums out. You know, it might have to be something that Gene actually produced, because Gene Simmons produced the 3rd and 4th Black and Blue albums, and maybe a song like Nasty Nasty. And a funny story about that, I don't know if anybody knows the song Nasty Nasty, but Gene actually helped write the song with us too. We had a riff and we put it together, and then we needed a middle part, so he had this a riff that he said, this would work good for the middle of the song, so we put it in. And later on, I had run into Paul Stanley. I didn't know him that well, but we were at the studio where Kiss was doing some recording, and he said something, hey, I heard that new song you guys have, and he goes, that middle part really sounds familiar.
What
were you? You know, Nasty Nasty goes, bom, 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 bom. And then the middle part is this thing that goes, bom, do, 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 do. So it's old, yeah, you're right, it's off the Elder, and Gene just borrowed something from his record and then gave it to us, and we didn't, you know, unknowingly to us, so.
Yeah, I didn't see a writing credit there.
But the kind of, there's more to this story though, so the song Nasty Nasty, Gene ended up, I think he kind of ripped it off actually, the riff to Nasty Nasty, because it goes bom, 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 bom. And that became Domino, so, hey, we steal a little bit, he steals a little bit, we love it. So it's, we borrow it, I should say.
I want to stick with Black and Blue, because you guys were an incredible band. You've got a lot of fans of that band, and we've gotten a lot of questions, so I'm going to ask just a couple general, and forgive me if I don't mention your name, but we had repetition on this. What was your favorite Black and Blue album, and what was the favorite song? Your favorite song that you did?
You know, I think either the first album or the second album. The problem with Black and Blue, and looking back in retrospect, is I think we could have done better than we did. We did all right, but I don't think we stuck to what we were in the beginning. When we started out in Portland, you know, we were kind of a hard rock, heavy metal band, you know, kind of a down and dirty band with that kind of approach. And then we kind of got, over time, pulled in different directions, which is not unusual when you're on a major label. And then you have bands like Bon Jovi breaking huge. You know, the label's going to want to get you on the radio and do those sort of things, so they try to talk you into being more commercial. So I think our first album was more true to what we were. And there's songs on there like Hold On to 18 and School of Hard Knocks and The Strong Will Rock. It's really what we were about. And when we did the second album, we were starting to get pushed in different directions, and we should have stuck more to our guns, but the second album was really great. We did it in Vancouver with Bruce Fairburn and Bob Rock. And it's a fabulous record called Without Love. But I don't know if stylistically, if it's getting more pop and got away from what we really were in the beginning, and I think that's confusing to fans, so you know, it's hard to say.
But the labels did that to a lot of bands. It seemed like if a band hit big, whether it be Bon Jovi or Guns N' Roses, whoever, then they want you to make a record that sounds like whatever is selling a million copies.
Yeah, but you know, in all fairness, the labels, they have a lot of money on the line, and they're investing in a band, and they want to make it successful. They want hits, they want songs on the radio, so you do get pushed in different directions. Interesting story about after we did our second album, Without Love, Bon Jovi heard the record, he thought it sounded so good that he decided he was going to go to Vancouver and hire Bruce Fairburn and Bob Rock to do his next record. And his next record was Slippery When Wet, so
wow.
It's interesting what happens. And he's talked about that in interviews before too, so I just thought it was cool that he mentioned that, and he talked about Black and Blue and how that record made, you know, influenced his decision to go up to Vancouver, British Columbia, and record Slippery When Wet.
Well, yeah, that's huge, especially when you have a contemporary that calls you out and says, yeah, I like the way this sounds. Now, for those of you, I'm assuming most of you that are here are Kiss fans, know that Tommy grew up also as a Kiss fan. So, at one point, did Peter Criss come in to do backing vocals? Because Mr. Zero wants to know about that. And can you tell us what that was like, or meeting him for the first time? Was that like, oh my gosh, this is really, you know?
Yeah, you know, it's funny because going back, even before I played guitar, I was a Kiss fan. And it was really Kiss that kind of inspired me along with some other groups to take up guitar, because I wanted to be in a band and I just loved the bands and the music. But fast forward, when we were working on our third album, in Black and Blue, called Nasty Nasty, which is one of the ones that Gene produced. Somehow we brought up the idea of, wouldn't it be cool if Peter Criss would come and maybe sing on a song or do something on our album? And we said, Gene, could you call Peter and see if he'd be into doing that? And so I don't think Gene had talked to him in a while. And so Gene called Peter, and Peter came to the studio, and when he came in, it was like, wow, you know, Peter Criss, I can't believe he's here, and he's actually gonna record with us. And Gene and Peter, this was in 1986, and it was kind of a reunion of sorts for them, because they hadn't seen each other for years, at least for a few years. And so, you know, they were all hugs and, you know, God, it's great to see you. And just kind of I think they were happy to be together and see each other at that point too. So there was a song we had called Best in the West, and Peter did some background vocals, and he did some vocal ad-libs on it that were really cool. And we always loved Peter's voice, at least I did growing up. I thought, you know, when he sang Black Diamond and some of those other tunes, it was, you know, he sounded great. And, you know, Nothing to Lose. So I was always, Jamie, our singer from Black and Blue, and myself, we always loved Peter Criss and the way his voice sounded. So we thought it was cool.
Well, yeah, I mean, you've got someone that you admired growing up, and now they're singing on your record. You've got a guy that's producing your record. That you must have been just like, wow, this is really actually happening.
Yeah, it was unbelievable, actually, because we're just these guys, we're these young guys from Portland, Oregon, and to have Gene Simmons suddenly coming to your rehearsal each day to work pre-production for the album. And at the time, they were on tour in 86, and I'm not sure if it was Asylum or which record, but on days off, he would literally fly back to L.A. just for the day, just to rehearse, come to our rehearsal, and he was really diligent, and I was really impressed with how, you know, how much effort he put into it, and he did a great job, and he definitely worked hard at it.
Yeah, and that gives you confidence, too, I would think, going in when you have someone that's producing that believes in what you're doing.
Absolutely, yeah. So he was, he came on board, he really championed our cause and really helped us out a lot. And the relationship then obviously grew a lot then too, because when I met Gene and Paul and Eric Carr and Bruce Kulick In 1985, when Black and Blue was the opening act on the Kiss Asylum tour, we did about 25 dates in the fall of 85, Midwest, East Coast, down in the South a bit, Texas, and we were just blown away that we were actually on tour with Kiss, who were really our heroes growing up.
Yeah.
And that was just mind-boggling. We'd get there in the afternoon, we thought, well, maybe we could get to talk to them during the day, or maybe they'd pass us in the hallway and we could, you know, chat them up a little bit. And, you know, Gene was the one that was more talkative all the time, as you know, and Paul's a little more standoffish, at least to begin with. So we got to know Gene more to begin with. And then that's why we ended up asking Gene to produce our third record then, after the course of that tour.
Those are amazing stories to be a part of all of that, you know, and which led to all the rest of this.
It did, you know, because things just progressed. So after Gene worked with us, then he asked me to come write with him for the Hot in the Shade record, which they were working on, and I ended up being lucky enough to have two songs that I co-wrote on the Hot in the Shade record, Street Giveth, Street Taketh Away, and a song called Betrayed. I'm sure you guys know those.
Yes.
And,
you can clap, it's okay.
The great little story about this, so back then I was pretty poor, you know, I was just a struggling musician, I was staying on people's couches, and I got those songs on that Kiss album, and I thought, oh, you know, this is going to be good, because Kiss, you know, they sell a million records, so this could be good for some songwriting royalties. So one day I came home, and I opened my mailbox, and there was a check from Polygram Publishing Company, who published the songs, and I opened the check. It was a $25,000 check.
Wow, nice.
And I was like, well, okay.
This could be our life.
Now we're starting to go the right direction here. So that was really a big event for me when I got that $25,000. I'd never had $1,000 in my life, and to have this check, and I put it in the bank, and it was just, you know, that was a turning point. I thought, man, maybe I can make it in this business and be a musician.
Yeah, and that's the kind of stuff I love to hear about, is how when you start to have that success, that feeling you get, and you start to can say, look, I think I'm going to do this. Do you have any advice you can give people here tonight, not necessarily musicians or being a rock star or anything like that, but just in life, about following what you really believe in?
Yeah, it's really true. It doesn't matter if you're a musician or whatever you're doing in life, because it's more about the effort. I know you hear that a lot, but really it's the perseverance and the stick-to-itiveness, and just not really giving up, just keep doing what you're doing. And I don't think it has to necessarily be towards one goal either. It could just be whatever you're doing in life. You just keep doing it and do it as well as you can. But don't give up, don't change, don't doubt yourself, and you just keep going, because one thing leads to another. Because I don't think I don't think life is linear. I don't think you decide what you're going to do and then you just go straight towards it. I think it's, you go this way, one thing leads to another, and you take a turn. And, you know, because I've gone through all kinds of things in my life to get where I am now, and I never honestly would have thought, I didn't think I was going to be where I am now. I always worked hard, and I just, you know, took an opportunity, and I just stuck with it and didn't give up on things, even when I wanted to give up sometimes.
Yeah.
Because back before I was actually the guitar player in Kiss, I was road managing and working behind the scenes, and there were some points there, honestly, where I thought, I'm going to quit this. I can't handle it. Because we were in the car ride coming over, and I was telling Tommy, being a tour manager or a road manager is one of the most difficult things that anybody could do. It's a tough job. It's 24/7. It's a no-win situation in most situations, because everybody, you can't keep everybody happy all the time, and everybody turns to you and blames you for everything. So there's a couple situations where I was just like, I can't handle this anymore. I'm not going to do it. So, but now in retrospect, I'm really happy that I did stick with it and I didn't go home. You know?
Well, yeah, and I'm assuming you also learned a lot from that experience, which also helped you get to where you are now.
Well, definitely. I mean, it was a good conditioning, that's for sure.
Yeah. This next question, I'm assuming, is a Kiss question. This is from Danny Halverson. What one song do you wish you could play or play more often? Is there a Kiss song that you wish you guys were doing?
Well, there's a couple. There's one that I keep pushing to do, and for some reason, it just never happens. I really love the song All Hell's Breaking Loose.
Yeah.
You know? And every time I bring it up when we rehearsal, to Gene and Paul, they're just like, oh, I don't know. For some reason, they just are not into doing it. I'm not sure why, but I keep trying. And Eric and I, we work on these guys, and especially when we're getting ready for the Kiss cruise.
Yeah.
You know, going for those deep tracks and trying to persuade these guys to do, you know, stuff that people don't usually hear, especially for the Kiss cruise, because people on the cruise expect to hear the more obscure, deeper tracks.
And there was a video for that song. It got pretty good play on MTV, so it's not completely unfamiliar.
Yeah, I don't really get it. For some reason, they're just not into that song for some reason.
And I've noticed on tour, seeing a bunch of shows, that people are really responding well to the 80s material.
Yeah, it definitely. There's a lot of great 80s stuff. Sometimes it's harder for Paul now, because singing the 80s stuff is so high, it's just almost impossible. So that is a stumbling block with that. But anyway, it's one. We've been rehearsing for these cruises, and Eric and I will say, let's do The Oath, you know, let's do Kissin' Time, you know. And Gene and Paul, they'll turn to us and they'll go, really? And we go, yeah, no, people really love it. They go, are you sure? Yeah, I guarantee you. So then, of course, we go to the cruise and we play The Oath, and people are just going insane. And then we look at those guys and say, see, I told you.
Well, I don't mean to embarrass you, but I want to say, I've gotten to know Tommy pretty well over the last several years. He is truly one of the kindest, most humble, nicest people I've ever met. And he is so responsible for how much cool stuff is going on with the band. Because you are. You were involved in everything from the Kiss releases of the Kiss Vision, all that stuff. You know, the...
Thank you.
Round of applause.
There might be something for that. I'm not going to take all the credit. I appreciate that.
The next question is from Krista, and I'm assuming... She wants to know, why did you choose to play guitar? I'm assuming versus drums or a different instrument.
Well, you know, I started out when I was 10 or 11 years old. You know, you're in grade school, and in fifth grade they say, do you want to be in the band or the orchestra, or do you want to sing in the choir? And I thought, I'll be in the band. And for some reason I chose saxophone. I don't know why, but so I started playing saxophone. I was probably about 10. And then we had a guitar at the house, at my parents, at our house. It was a really crappy, cheap acoustic guitar called a Stella. Really cheap, and it only had 5 strings on it. But I was picking that thing up, because this is when I was starting to discover bands like Black Sabbath and Deep Purple and Kiss, and you know, early to mid-70s, probably 72, 73. And I just really wanted to play guitar, so I actually had a little recorder, cassette recorder, and had a microphone, and put a tape in it, you hit record, and put the mic in to the sound hole of the acoustic guitar, it actually kind of amplifies it, and I thought that was really cool, so I did that for a while, but I was playing saxophone, but I didn't really love the saxophone, honestly, as much as I loved the guitar and rock and roll music and all that. So my mom finally said, I'll help you buy an electric guitar, but you have to make a deal with me that you'll continue to play the saxophone until you graduate from high school. So I said, of course I'll do that. So I played sax all through until 12th grade, but she helped me buy my first electric guitar. So, you know, it was just, I just loved the guitar players and the way it looked and the bands and the music at the time. And it was just something I really wanted to do.
That's cool, you know. And this one, you'll like this one. Wayne Z wants to know, what is it like to work with and tour with Eric Singer?
Some of my friends are here, like Keith LaRue, and he knows Eric really well, and you know Mark and Jeannie. But Eric is an interesting guy. You know, he's really hyper, I think he has ADD, no doubt about it.
Maybe a little.
He cannot focus on one subject for more than 15-20 seconds, and then it's on. It's funny. We'll be sitting in backstage. Band, we're eating dinner or something, and you know, we'll start a conversation, Gene or Paul, or we're talking about something interesting, something current events or something, and Eric will jump in for about 10 seconds, and then suddenly he'll be talking about something else, or he'll ask somebody else another question, and then he'll jump that and go to another question, and there's 3 subjects all of a sudden going on, and Paul and Gene and I are looking at each other like, what's going on with this guy, you know? He's one of the nicest guys you'll ever know. He's got really the biggest heart of anybody I think I've ever met. He's really giving, and he really cares and he's real sensitive and he loves his friends. And but Eric's, I think he's hard to get to know a little bit too. I think when you first meet him, he's a little standoffish. And I've heard some people think or say that he's, you know, I don't know, he doesn't seem very friendly in the first place. But once you get to know him, he's going to be your best friend forever. But he's one of a kind. There's no doubt about it.
Yes, he is. This next question is from Roger. And we touched on a little bit, but I want to expand. Who were your influences growing up, and did you ever dream growing up to join KISS?
You know, like I said, I loved Black Sabbath. I loved Ritchie Blackmore and Deep Purple. I was a big Montrose fan. Ronnie Montrose is probably one of my biggest influences on guitar. Davy Johnstone from Elton John's band, Pat Travers, Robin Trower, Johnny Winter, you know, all the great guitar players in the 70s, Jimmy Page, you know, Jeff Beck, Eric Clapton, I think they influenced me, but they were a little before my time. Cream was more late 60s, and I was not really quite getting into things quite then. So I'm kind of more in the second generation of, you know, the Ace Frehleys, Joe Perry or Ritchie Blackmore, the guys that kind of came next.
Well, and we talked about Davy Johnstone because we both love Goodbye Yellow Brick Road and the Elton John stuff. He's another one of those kind of behind-the-scenes guys that is just incredible.
Yeah, that you don't hear the name as much. But, you know, these days I think Joe Bonamassa is incredible. I think Steve Lukather is an amazing guitar player. And there's so many good guitar players out there. It's mind-boggling.
Yeah, it really is. The next one is from... Oh gosh, I want to say it's Carla, maybe. I'm sorry, I can't read the writing. What's your daily routine on a concert day? How do you do your day?
Well, fortunately, with KISS, as big of a tour as we're on, we have our own airplane, which is a good thing. And so it gives us the ability, really, to sleep in, and then we don't have to leave the hotel till probably 1 or 2 o'clock, and I'm talking about in the city we just played in. So we played in, like last night's not a good example because we left right after the show, but if we played like in Minneapolis or St. Paul tomorrow night, we're gonna stay, and then the next day we don't have to get up really and leave the hotel till about 1 or 2 o'clock. So we'll then fly to the next city, which might take 45 minutes to an hour, and then we'll end up getting over to the venue by 4 o'clock.
Right.
And then when we get to the venue, there's just maybe things like doing a sound check, even though we don't really sound check too much once we get going on the tour, we'll do it to begin with. You know, we're signing merchandise, kind of getting something to eat. We have some catering and we'll get a light dinner, that kind of thing. But then we start the makeup process, which we give at least 2 hours to do because we do our own makeup. I think everybody probably knows that, but we don't have makeup people that do it for us. Everybody in KISS's eyes done their own makeup. So we'll start that about 5:30, 6 o'clock, because we have to be ready at 8 o'clock. And the makeup process is something we do every night. I can't imagine not doing it. It's really the transition in getting ready for a KISS show, putting the makeup on.
Well, what was it like, if you can remember, the first time you put it on and you're about to play your first show, looking in the mirror, what was that like?
Well, you know, it's different for me, though, because I was in a tribute band.
Understood. And this is the band.
Yeah. So, but I refer to that, though, because I did the tribute band for a while called Cold Gin. We just did it for fun. But we put makeup on, so I knew how to do it. And I knew how to get up and play guitar and play KISS in makeup.
Yeah.
Even though it was kind of a funny little thing. But so when I finally got to the first show, which was, I was just filling in actually, was a private concert down in Jamaica in February 2002. But that was a mind-boggling experience, of course. I'm going on stage as part of KISS. And
yeah.
It's like, how did this happen?
You know, really? Yeah, it's like, you know, cool things just keep happening.
Yeah, it is weird. I mean, you had asked a question a minute ago, did I ever aspire to being in KISS when I was starting to play guitar, and I really never did. I was just doing because I love what I love doing, and I love being in a band and just having my own bands. I never thought about being in KISS someday. I never did.
Yeah, you just wanted to be a professional musician and make that your living.
Yeah, and not even really wanting to be a professional musician. In the beginning, it was more about just wanting to play guitar in a band and get up on stage like this and just play for people and have that experience.
Do you still have some of that? I mean, because I'm assuming the crowd gives you the energy and that, but do you still marvel at it even though you're used to it?
Oh, no doubt about it. Every night I never take it for granted. I get up there, I love what I'm doing, and it's just, I still can't believe I'm up on stage doing this. It's just a very cool thing, so.
I can't even imagine, because you're living the dream of so many people in this room.
I know, it's weird.
You know? Yeah. You can clap, it's good. Barbie would like to know, and you may not be able to answer this, what's next for you after the final tour?
You know, I get asked that question a lot in interviews these days, and I don't really know. We've got about another year and a half to go on this tour.
As
I'm sure everybody, most people here know, we're on the End of the Road World Tour right now. We've been on, this tour started about a year ago, and we've got about a year and a half to go because the last show is going to be July 17th, 2021 in New York City. So, but I don't really know exactly what my plans are at the end of this. Kiss is not going to go away, though, either. The band's not going to tour, but Kiss music, the identities and the characters and the brand,
merchandise,
that'll all continue on. And I think Kiss will continue on in some way.
Well,
I can't imagine it not.
You know? When I heard that there's going to be another video or DVD release for another Kissology, is that true?
Well, we have a Kissology that's halfway done already, and it's going to be Kissology 4, but I do know that an authorized documentary is being done right now. We've been interviewed.
Yep.
There's a guy that's doing it, John Dorsey, and we're working on that, and I know that there's a talk of a feature film in the works, too. I know Doc's been working on that, too. So.
Which would be great, and now look at all of the ones with the Elton John and Queen. There should be a Kiss film too, but you guys have such a long history that it would almost have to be an 8-hour thing.
A miniseries.
A miniseries on Netflix. You touched on this a little bit earlier, but I want to revisit it a little bit. Rob Collier wants to know, of all the different roles that you've had with Kiss, what has been your favorite role and what has been the most challenging role for you?
I know it seems weird, but that doing the road management, that whole part, that was the most challenging thing I've ever done in my life. I know people want to hear it's more about something to do with being in the band and that sort of thing. But actually, when I got into the band in the first place, when I first officially was in the band, the first show we did was the Kiss Symphony show over in Melbourne.
Yes.
2003. Looking back now, I have to admit it was a pretty pressure situation to be in, you know, because you've got Ace, who left the band. Those are big shoes to fill, obviously, and a lot of expectations, and it's almost a no-win situation in a way, because you know, you're going to be, how are you going to do this, and how are you going to go about it besides just doing it, you know, and so it was difficult at the beginning to jump into that role and do that. Even though I was really happy about it, there was a lot of pressure, and it wasn't easy to begin with. And there's took a lot of flack too. You know?
Oh yeah. Well, but you've really made it your own. It's its own character. It really, truly is.
Well, as the Spaceman, and I think as time goes on, by the time we did Monster, I feel like the guitar playing on Monster is more, you know, it's Kiss, but it's me more too. I think that Sonic Boom is really good, but I think some of the stuff on there is a little derivative sounding, even though it's a great record. And we really just wanted to make a classic Kiss record. With Sonic Boom, but Monster, I think, is a little more us, or a little more me, but being Kiss at the same time. And then, you know, in present day tours, you know, like the new outfit, it's a new design and something that I was involved in putting together as well. And just the whole approach now, even the guitar solo we're doing now. I mean, of course, I'm doing the Rockets, which is you know, an Ace thing to begin with. But at the end, we're doing this rapid fire thing, and it's so there's some new things that are going on that are exciting and a little bit different, which, you know, I can call a little bit more my own a little bit.
Well, and I like Sonic Boom and Monster. I love those records. And to one point, Lightning Strikes, I love that song. I would love to hear you play that live, and I know that you don't always have the decision on all of that.
Well, but I understand it, though, too, because I love the song, too, but most people don't know When Lightning Strikes. They don't know Out of This World as much, and when we go out there and do a show in a big place on this tour, we have to do the songs that people know more to get their reaction, keep the excitement up, and if we did those songs, most people wouldn't know them, I don't think, so.
Could be, but you know, as there's so many hardcore fans there too, but I get it, you're playing to a large amount of people, and not everybody's a hardcore fan, some of them are coming just for the experience and seeing you the first time, all of that.
Yeah.
So that plays into it as well. Have you talked at all about doing another Kiss record, or is that just off the table?
Yeah.
We were actually talking about, not a Kiss record the other day, I was talking to Paul, and we were talking about other, you know, I think Bon Jovi has a new record, you know, people are doing records, and the discussion is, you know, is it really worth doing it? I know that the fans would love it, and we enjoy making it, but it does take a lot of time.
Yeah.
And the net result, though, is that nothing happens, you know, because people aren't really buying records or buying music anymore, for the most part, so it's, you know, that's kind of frustrating, and it comes off looking like it's a, you know, it's a disappointment, or it's not a success then, because nobody's buying the records, so.
Right. It's the world we live in now.
Yeah.
Everything's changed.
We'll buy it.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
That's one.
But you know, that's why, but on these last few tours, you know, I was doing Shock Me. The reason I was doing it, because it's a known, that's a song that's been around. It's on Love Gun. People know that song.
Yeah.
So that's why we were doing it, but, and not the other songs that, off Sonic Boom and Monster, so. It's just, you have to play the stuff that gets the reaction and keeps the excitement level up.
Yeah, you want every single song to be that high energy through the whole thing.
Yeah. Unless you're on the Kiss Cruise, it's a different situation.
Yeah, that's, you know, well, yeah, that's a whole other animal. Bradley, I think it's Reitler, would like to know, when you're on tour, how many costumes do you have? How many copies of your costume do you have on tour with you?
We have three. Basically, I have three outfits. They switch them out each day. The vest that I wear, that kind of mirrored thing, there's three of those. So you switch them out because we get so sweaty on stage. It's a question of getting them dried out and ready for another time. So we rotate them to keep things kind of fresh too, because if you wear one outfit, it just kind of gets beat down after a while. I have two or three pairs of the boots, but I stick with one pair because they're most comfortable.
Oh.
But it makes sense, you know, because you...
I love it.
The ladies know that when you're on heels all the time, your feet get friggin' sore, you know? And so you want to go with the most comfortable pair.
That makes sense, and you can't just take it to a dry cleaner.
You know? Yeah.
And I heard in the early days that costumes would stand up on their own.
Yeah, back in the old days, I heard the stories that, you know, they were leather, and they just had one outfit, so they literally, the next night, they'd be cold and stale and stinky, and but jeans is always stinky. I liken it to a dumpster smell.
Great.
You know, so when I get up there and we do cold gin, and then the part where Gene comes over and, you know, he starts trying to lick my face and all that stuff, it's just hideous. You don't want Gene Simmons drooling on you. Horrible. It's all part of the show.
So we're going to try something new here that we haven't done before. We have a special guest who is going to ask a question, but I have to play it on the phone. So everyone just, okay?
Tommy, it's Bruce Kulick here. My question is, we're all aware of your talent as a musician and performer in KISS, but you've also had the unique opportunity to be creatively involved in the making of KISSTERY and the KISS box set, etc. Can you share some of the challenges of working on those projects with Gene and Paul? That's my question.
Wow, that's cool. Bruce. I love Bruce. I'm sure a lot of you guys have met Bruce, but he's just such an incredible guy. I just love him. Bruce, and he was, just before I get to the answer real quick, when we toured on that Asylum tour, when Black and Blue opened for KISS, Bruce was really one of the first people to really just, you know, be friendly and you know, talk to me, and I couldn't believe I was talking to Bruce Kulick, you know?
Yeah.
And I actually had this guitar that I wanted to sell, and it was a guitar that he wanted to buy. It was a Charvel, which I don't usually play. It was like a Strat, you know, with the whammy bar and all that. And I had this guitar, and he ended up buying it, and I couldn't believe it. I'm selling a guitar to Bruce Kulick, you know, and I'm hanging out. It was cool. So anyway, Bruce asked about Kistry and getting involved doing these projects, like the Kiss box set. And actually, the Kistry book was the first project that I was hired with Kiss to do. After Black and Blue ran its course, of course I knew Gene and Paul because Gene had worked with the band and I had written with those guys a bit. So they asked me to come work for them at one point. I think it was about 92 or 93. They said, we have a project we're working on called Kistry. It's going to be a 9-pound coffee table book and we need you to help us choose photos for the book. And I thought, well, that doesn't suck. I like this. I get to go get paid to look at Kiss photos and work with Kiss. It's like, okay, this is great. So I really worked hard at it, and I was working long hours and very diligent, get there early, leave late, and you know, I was working very hard. But it was cool because they had all these boxes of photos that were in storage in New Jersey for many years. It was all the stuff from the 70s, mostly like color slides, and they were in slide sheets and binders and thrown in these cardboard boxes, and they weren't stored very well, you know, and in some cases some of the photos might have got damaged because it wasn't temperature controlled or
right.
So they had shipped all these old boxes out, and they were all, these boxes were at Paul's house, and there was probably 50 boxes, and each box was full of binders with slides. So my job was to go through each box, pull out the binder, take the slides out, and we were going to put them in slide carousels, you know, so we could view them easier and store them in carousels. So that was my job, to pull the slides out, and sometimes if they were damaged or, you know, the cardboard thing that might have fallen apart, I had to fix those. And so, but along the way, as I was going through the slides, my job was to pick photos that were really cool to go in Kistry. And they needed a lot of them because it was a big book. So
yeah.
It was a great job. And I remember going through these binders and, wow, this is Finn Costello from when they went to, you know, the Hollywood, you know, walk. They were at the Chinese Theater in Hollywood in 1976, and here's the original photos, and I'm just like, wow, this is amazing. I got to go through all that, and it was that was a cool experience, and I was getting paid to do it, and I couldn't believe it.
That's even better.
Yeah, so it was a great job, and then what we did was, the Kistry book was done just by the band themselves, so Gene and Paul literally just bought a computer. They hired this designer, her name was Susan McOwen, she was from Indianapolis, and they moved around and into Gene's guest house and set up this computer. And remember, 1992, 93, computers were pretty rudimentary back then.
Yeah.
So you had this big tower, and we didn't have much storage, you know, not even a gig, you know, I don't know what it was back then, but, you know, it was all floppy disks and stuff. And it was, I had a scanner, and I was scanning the photos for the book. But the scans were so bad, they were so low res that we did the design with the low-res scans, and you didn't get the high-res scans done until you sent all the photos, the original photos, to the printer, and then they had real scanners back then, but we didn't have the ability to even scan, but I chose the stuff, and then I scanned them real low-res, and it was just a real little homemade little organization there, and it was just Gene. Paul wasn't really that over that much. It was Gene and Susan and I, and we just worked on it. Put this thing together.
That's incredible. Yeah, you know, and growing up as a Kiss fan, that must have been so exciting for you too. Like you said, to see all of these iconic images, and they're all just in a box, and you're like thinking, you know,
it's almost like, yeah, this shouldn't be in this box. These photos should be like, you know, stored and presented, you know, properly. And
yeah.
it was just all this in this lousy box, and they were dusty. I couldn't believe it.
Well, do you think though, also in all fairness, that even when they started out and ended up creating what they created, that they had no concept or thought behind, like, who knows if anyone would even care about this in 10 years or whatever?
Well, it's so true. I think they started out, even with the makeup, it was so crude to begin with, and it evolved over time. I don't think they really even knew what they were onto. And now it's obviously, you know, it's just iconic image, you know, imagery and characters. And they were just kind of fiddling around, trying to be kind of glammy and wear makeup, do something different. And I don't think they really had an idea. And I think that Bill Coyne, I think, had a lot to do with getting these guys off the ground to begin with. As you guys know, he was the original manager, and I think he was the one that had that kind of show business, you know, he had TV background, and I think that he really brought the ability to market and present this thing the right way, and I think that he had a lot to do with that. Not to discredit Gene and Paul and Ace and Peter, but I think they were just musicians and they were filling around, but I think Bill O'Coin really gave it a direction.
Well, yeah, it's like you need someone with a vision, and they were probably wrapped up in the middle of it.
Yeah. And so, to your point, I think as time goes by, I don't think back then they were thinking, oh, we need to preserve these photos, or, you know, back then they were just happy to have somebody taking their photo.
Yeah.
And it's going to be in a magazine. It's going to be in Cream or Circus Magazine, and that's all they cared about.
Yeah, and which makes
who
sense.
Who owns the photo? Well, I don't know. It's like we go back now and all these, we have issues with, you know, who owns the rights to the photos in these things, because it was never really established back then. They were just happy to get a photo taken, you know?
Yeah, and then now I suppose when you want to use it, you got to make sure that you have all the clearances so you don't have a problem.
Yeah, because people will start suing and doing them, and they have, you know? So.
And that's why, like, Let It Be, to this day, still isn't out on video.
Is that right?
There's just too many people with fingers in the pie, and no one wants to give up a percentage. I know, that's what I heard.
Yeah.
What is the strangest thing you ever received from a fan?
I don't know if I can tell you.
Come on, tell me you're
on the dirt.
Yeah, within reason.
Yeah, maybe some photos. Thanks. Use your imagination. It all happens, trust me.
What does your family think about you being in KISS?
You know, I've been very fortunate. My mom and dad aren't alive anymore, but my dad was a conservative guy, and he was an Army Brigadier General, and he was a Republican, you know, very conservative, but he was also very open-minded, so when I wanted to play music or do these things or try it, he was like, you know, go for it, give it a shot. I was lucky that my parents were never saying to me, you can't do that, or you know, it'll never happen, you know, discouraging kind of stuff. They were always like encouraging and optimistic about it. I think they wanted me to go to college at the time, but I wanted to pursue music when I got out of high school, so they said, cool, give it a shot for a while. And luckily things started rolling along, but you know, it's just like any of you guys, you know, your parents, they care about you, they love you, you know, they want the best for you, and they want you to maybe think about college and things like that, but luckily they didn't poo-poo it, they just let me take a shot at it, so they were cool that way. Yeah.
So were some of your siblings, like, if they tell their friends, yeah, my brother's in KISS, they're like, yeah, right.
Yeah. Well, it's funny, yeah, because family or my cousins, people didn't, you know, there's actually some Thayers here. I don't know if we're related, but that's not that common of a name, but yeah, but it's funny sometimes because I think, yeah, for my family, my brother's in KISS, and they're like, oh, yeah, right. I mean, I even walk into places and they go, yeah, I'm in KISS, and they go, yeah, right. No, really. Yeah.
I want to talk a little bit about your father, because I know that he had such a big influence on your life, and some of the stuff that you wrote about him, expressing how you felt or feel about him. He had passed away, what, 2 years, a year and a half
about
ago?
About a year and a half ago.
Okay. We're just absolutely beautiful, and I sent you a note saying, you know, because my dad was so important to me. Can you tell us a little bit about what you're doing now in his memory?
Yeah, and just a little background. My dad was 96 when he passed away a year and a half ago, so my parents were always a little older for some reason. We had 5 siblings in our family, 4 boys and 1 girl, and my parents didn't have their kids until they were like close to 40, and in the late 50s, early 60s, that was a little unusual because most people were starting their families when they were in their 20s. So, like when I was in school, all my friends' parents were about 10 years younger than my parents. So. But anyway, my dad was a real successful business community leader in Portland. But he was also had a heroic career in the Army. He fought in World War II over in Europe in 1945, led a platoon. He was a young officer leading a platoon through France and Germany and into Austria. A lot of crazy stories. They had direct combat with SS troops, and you know, people were killed and all that kind of stuff. You know, so it was a pretty horrific scene. But the most horrific thing that happened was when they got into Austria in May of 45, they discovered and liberated a satellite. It was a Nazi death camp. And it was a satellite camp of Mauthausen, which is in Austria, which is a big camp.
Yep.
And this was called Gunskirchen. There was about 15,000 to 20,000 Hungarian Jewish refugees there. And they literally saved the lives of about 15,000 people that day. And
that's amazing.
And, wow. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
where you were the first time you heard your one of your songs on the radio?
Yeah, that was in Black and Blue, yeah. Actually. And first time it would have been in Portland, because before we moved to L.A., we were on, there was a radio station up there called KGON 92 FM, and they did a homegrown album, and I think one of our songs was on that. So that was the first time, but really for real was when the Black and Blue album came out in August 1984. I heard on the radio then, I was in Portland visiting, and I went and took the album into the station, and they debuted it, you know, and I was on the radio, so that was a cool thing. But actually, hearing it, it was in L.A. on KLOS or KMET, and there was another great AM station called KNAC down there also. But really the cool thing is, back then, though, you'd be sitting at home, and remember when MTV first started, and you're like, let's watch MTV, you know, we'd watch it all day, you know, and then you'd be watching MTV, and our video of Hold On To 18 would come on MTV. That was special. I mean, I remember being at a party, and like, it came on, and we're like, look, it's us.
Yeah, that's when they played videos.
So that was, the MTV thing was a big thing back then.
We have time for two more questions. There's a lot of people who follow you that are very interested in your stage gear or the type of effects and things you use. Can you speak a little bit to what you use and why you use it?
Yes. My approach has always been very traditional and really simple. A lot of guitar players have all these pedals and things and, you know, outboard gear, whatever you call it. But my philosophy has been keep it really simple. Just get a good guitar and do a really good amp with one chord, and that's where you're going to get your best tone. And I think it's really true. So I've been playing Gibson guitars. I've stuck with Gibson, and then also Epiphone, which is the sister company.
Your signature models.
My signature models. But those are good guitars. And the Les Paul is what I've always played. It's a classic rock and roll guitar, going back 50 years now. And I think I grew up playing a Les Paul originally because it was the guys that I looked up to, you know, the Jimmy Pages, the Ace Frehleys, the Davy Johnstones. These guys were playing Les Pauls, and I dreamed about having a Les Paul when I first was learning to play guitar, and eventually I got one. So I would have never imagined having a signature model later on like I do. So it's a Les Paul, and then my amplifiers are called Hughes & Kentner, and they're German made. And they're really, you know, it's a high-end German amp. They're tube amps, very old school, so they're really like a good old Marshall, actually. They're really warm, they're really loud, and I use 300-watt Hughes & Kentner heads and three 412 cabinets on stage. And actually, these days with the in-ears, though, we don't even have the cabinets on the stage. Our cabinets are underneath the stage. Because you don't really need them there, because you're hearing everything in the in-ear monitors. You get your monitor mixed that way.
Yeah.
I do have one cabinet under Eric's drum riser pointing at me on stage, because I need it for getting... Sometimes I get a feedback sound where you're sustaining a note.
Yeah.
And so I have that up there for that, to kind of help with the tone a little bit. But it's pretty straight ahead. I don't use any effects except in my guitar solo. When I get towards the end of the solo, I put an octave divider on it, which is a... It makes the regular sound, but an octave below it, so it's a really ominous sound. And that's just for the thing at the end of the solo. But in the middle of Lick It Up, when we do that who part, the blum, 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 yeah. I put a chorus effect on for that. And then Do You Love Me, which is in the encores now, there's a part, you know, the bridge, the backstage pass, the number. I'm playing a arpeggio part, and that's got a chorus effect on it.
Cool. Yeah, there you go. Pretty for simple. All you gearheads.
Yeah.
Last question. What do you want people to remember about you?
Wow, that's heavy.
I know. It's a good way to end it, though.
Well, I hope that I can be an influence, a positive influence on people. My dad taught me to really try to help people and be giving, and it's kind of our civic duty. So I hope maybe people would remember me as a guy that tried to help out and contribute to society and try to help people or organizations, which I try to do when I can. And I think we all have to try to give. And I know it's hard because we're trying to make ends meet, and we have problems and issues and things, but try to contribute something to life and to your community. And I know it sounds corny, but I think it's really the heart really of what it's all about. And just relationships, the people, and, you know, nurturing good relationships. You know, my dad also told me, make sure people like you, you know, and I stuck with me that, and I think it's helped me that, you know, you're not kissing people's ass, but just get along with people and make an effort to be liked and be a good person. So hopefully I could be remembered that way.
Great answer. Well, everybody, thank you so much for attending. Let's give it up for Tommy Thayer, everybody.